Listos.
Okay, good morning. We are about to start the next section. First of all, I would like to thank the Latin American Center and San Antonio's College for having us today here, and to my colleagues in CAF for helping us to organize this event. And also, I'm very happy to be back here after 5 years. I was the Andres Bello Fellow in 2010 and have a fantastic time here with my colleagues at San Antonio's and the Latin American Center, so many memories are coming now here. As you may have gotten from the first presentation, this is a very hot topic for Latin America and for many reasons. One of the main reasons, in my opinion, is that informality is crucial for solving one of the big challenges that Latin America has, which is productivity. And we keep talking about how can we, go over the course of natural resources, how can we diversify the economies, and many of these topics that have to do with commodities and natural resources. But one of the conclusions that many of us reach is that we need to improve productivity and try to do better what we do and probably add value to what we are already doing. This is one of the important topics on productivity. And I think that Jose Antonio probably answered the question that this is the name of this panel, this informality over time, did it really decrease during the commodity boom? Apparently it did not. Because, you know, if we see many indicators, we see that poverty went down, even in some cases inequality went down. But in the case of informality, it seems that it remained very high. Many of you know that inequality in Latin America, in average, is around 50%, which is pretty high. And in some cases, it could even reach 70% in some countries and 40% in the countries that have the smaller informal sector. And I think one of the questions I will ask you, my speakers, to try to discuss in their presentations is why we have so much inequality. Is a problem of the educational system? Is a problem of the labor market? I think these kind of questions are relevant. We probably will discuss this in the next panels, but I think it's important. And also, I think it's also important to distinguish what kind of inequality we are talking about, because we have this inequality, which is people getting wages that are probably lower than the formal wage, and this is one. But the other one also was mentioned by Jose Antonio, which is people that is self-employed. And we have a report in CAF that shows that if these people will have the opportunity to have a formal job, probably they will be more productive if they move from that self-employment to a formal job, because there's a very low productivity in that. And, I think these are like the main issues I would like you to discuss. And, well, let's go with the first presentation. Also, I have to say that this panel is very close to CAF, because we are with the OECD and with the CEPAL, which are we are the co-authors of the Latin American Economic Outlook, so I feel among friends here. And actually, we have our professor, CAF, LAC professor, that is here because of the program that we have with the university. So we are very happy that our professors are also contributing to our conference and to our debate. So without further ado, I will give the floor to Roxana Maurizio.
Okay, thank you so much. I would like to first and to thank the organizers and LAC and CAF for inviting me to be here and to talk about the recent trends, specifically during the 2000s of labor informality, and discuss something about the future about these issues. The outline of this presentation is as follows. First, I will analyze the recent evolution of informality across the region. The recent means during the 2000s mainly. Then I will discuss the factors associated with the labor formalization verified in some Latin American countries during the last decade. Then I will let you discuss some impact of formalization on wage and distribution, the links between inequality and informality. And finally, I will discuss some future challenges of informality in Latin American countries. So let me start discussing or clarifying the different definitions, different approaches, as already mentioned by Professor Ocampo, the different approaches to labor informality. There are different approaches and conceptualization of labor informality, but I would like to say that here I will use just two different but complementary approaches to informality. The first one is the legal approach that, in fact, as already mentioned by Professor Ocampo, the legal approach associates informality with the evasion, the non-fulfillment of labor legislation, labor regulation. Under this approach, it is possible to distinguish between formal and informal employment, and in particular, looking at the informal or informal or formal salaried employment, we are referring to non-registered wage earners and wage earners not covered by the social security system. This is the traditional legal approach to informal employment or to informality, in particular in Latin America. But along with this approach, we have another approach to informality, the productive approach to informality, which associates informality with small enterprises and low productivity, low efficiency, where the main aim is survival rather than accumulation. And from this approach, it is possible to distinguish between formal and informal sector and employment in the informal and formal sector. And in particular, in order to measure the informal sector under this approach to informality, informal sector is made up of employers and employees in micro and small enterprises, together with unpaid and family workers, and together with a non-professional own account. So we have two complementary approaches to informality, and then we will see that the overlapping between these two approaches is very high in several Latin American countries. So having these approaches, taking into account these two approaches, let me start the presentation showing the recent evolution of informal employment from the legal approach and the complementary between this informal employment and inequality across the region. Here we have just the 2000s, not the comparison between the 90s and the 2000s. I want to look at in more detail the behavior of these dimensions during the 2000s in Latin America, the 2000s as a whole, without any differentiating between that period inside the 2000s. And here in particular, we have two indicators. In blue columns, we have the proportion of informal employment from the legal approach, the informal employment in total salaried employment. We have the change in this proportion along the decade. And in red, we have the change in the Gini coefficient of hourly wages during the 2000s. And we can say that regarding inequality, even when, of course, inequality continues to be one of the most critical issues in the Latin American countries, we can observe, as already mentioned by Professor Ocampo, that there was a reduction in inequality in the wage distribution along the decade in several Latin American countries. The exception is in Costa Rica, but in the rest of the countries, we can observe a positive trend regarding wage distribution during the last decade. This is particularly important considering the increasing trend in inequality verified in several Latin American countries during the 90s, but also it is important when comparing the current situation in other regions in the world. So this is an important positive aspect regarding the labor market, because here we are analyzing the wage distribution, the inequality in the wage distribution. But along with this positive trend, we can observe a very generalized reduction in the proportion of informal non-wage earners non-registered in the social security system. We can observe a reduction, very important reduction in some countries such as, for instance, Argentina, Brazil, Ecuador, Paraguay, Peru, or Uruguay. slide, this is the reduction in the proportion of informal workers in total salaried workers. So we have these very positive trends during the 2000s, even when then we will discuss about if they are sufficient or not, in particular to reverse the negative trends verified during the 90s. But if you look at the 2000s, we can observe at least these two very positive trends regarding labor market. This is particularly important considering the relevance of labor incomes in total family incomes in Latin American countries, and in particular considering the role of labor market in the reduction in poverty and in a reduction in global inequality. In particular here, for instance, we have the decomposition of the variation of the Gini coefficient of total family incomes according by source, different source of incomes. In particular, we are trying to decompose to explain the reduction in the variation of the Gini, the reduction, sorry, in the Gini coefficient of total family incomes, showing the blue row, according to the contribution of different income sources. For instance, labor incomes, pensions, CCT, conditional cash transfers, and other non-labor incomes. And we can see in this sample of countries that the main source, main income source explaining the reduction in the Gini coefficient of total family income come from the labor market. So again, as already mentioned by Professor Ocampo, the role of labor market is so crucial in order to understand the improvement in well-being, and in particular in this case, in order to understand the reduction in the total and more global inequality of income. In some countries, for instance, of course, in Argentina or in Uruguay, pensions also have an important role explaining this reduction in inequality, or in some countries such as in Brazil, Chile, or Mexico, CCTs also played an important role. But even in these cases, the role of the labor market was stronger than in the case of pension or CCTs. But what is even more important, when disaggregating labor incomes according if they come from a formal position, an informal position, or non-wage earning position, we can observe that with the exception of Paraguay or Mexico, in the rest of the countries, income from a formal job explain the most part of the reduction in total, the reduction in inequality in total family incomes. So the role of the labor market is so important to understand the reduction in inequality, but also the same picture appears when decomposing the poverty dynamics during the 2000s. Again, the role of the labor market is so important to explain the reduction in poverty during the 2000s, and in particular here we have the contribution of different kind of event. Here we have this kind of event that triggered exit from poverty. So this event that took families, initially poor families, out of poverty. So we can see here from the bottom to the top the contribution, for instance, in light green. We can see the contribution of exclusively labor event associated with this poverty exit rate, and we can see that this kind of event explain around from 30% in the case of Brazil to 70% in the case of Costa Rica. But then when we join exclusively labor event and the combination of exclusively labor event with non-labor event, we can observe again that the labor market event explain most part of the reduction in poverty, and in particular the most part of poverty exit rate. So again, the role of the labor market is so important in order to understand the reduction in global inequality and poverty. But let me go back to the cases of Argentina and Brazil, because in this story of this reduction in the legal informality in Latin America, these countries, together with, for instance, Peru or Uruguay, stand out because the reduction in informality was particularly strong during the 2000s. And here we have the evolution of the number, the absolute number of the, of employment by occupational category, distinguishing between, again, formal wage earners, informal, and non-wage earners. And we can see here in both countries, but again, the same pictures appears in other Latin American countries, we can observe, for instance, that in these two cases, the employment total employment grew up around 20% during this decade. But if you look at the evolution of registered wage earners, formal employment, we can observe that in the case of Argentina, the increase was around 60%, and in the case of Brazil, 40%. So the number of formal jobs, the increase in the number, was particularly important in these countries. This is, of course, in part associated with the reduction in the absolute number of informal occupation in both countries. So the idea here is to look at in more detail the channels of labor formalization. When we analyze in more dynamic perspective, trying to analyze the transitions around this labor formalization, we can observe that there are three different channels of labor formalization. The first, the most important channel, was the formalization in situ, the formalization in the same occupation, in the same job. That is to say, there were informal workers that were formalized in the same occupation. This channel explained around 50 or 60% of total formalization in both countries, but again, the similar numbers appears in other Latin American countries. The second channel of labor formalization was through the transition from unemployment or out of labor force to a formal employment, explaining around one third of total formalization. And finally, the third channel was associated with changing occupation, the transitions between different occupations, from a non-formal occupation to a formal occupation. But if you look at in more detail the formalization in situ, the most part was explained by the transition, the formalization of informal wage earners to formal wage earners, the transitions in the same occupation from non-registered wage earners that they were formalized, registered in the social security system. When we look at, so in more detail, this in situ formalization, in order to identify that the people that were formalized in this process, we can observe first that all group of workers were reached by this process of labor formalization. But the point here is that the intensity of this labor formalization was different across group of people. And in particular, one important point here is that if you analyze the characteristic of people who were formalized, we can observe that the groups of people that presented at the beginning of the period the highest rate of informality were benefited more intensively by this process. That this implied, in fact, that the initial formality gaps increased during this decade. Who were formalizing with more intensity? Prime age workers, men with the highest level of skill, working full time in large companies and with high tenure. So the important point here is the initially wage gap between workers in fact increased during the last decade. So the point here, the second question here, is the factors associated with this labor formalization during the 2000s, in particular in comparison with the increasing trend in informality during the 2000s. And I think that is not so easy to understand or to identify just one factor associated with the increase in the legal formalization during the 2000s. Rather, I think that there was a successful combination of a better macroeconomic and labor market situation together with the implementation of specific policies addressing informality. Regarding the first point, regarding the role of business cycle or the role of microeconomic regime, we have just here as an example these four countries, and for each of them we can see in blue columns the annual GDP growth since the 90s and the evolution of informality and unemployment. And we can say that on average as a whole the 2000s were characterized by a higher macroeconomic economic growth and more stability of this process of economic growth. So I think that this is important to recognize the stability of the the economic growth in order to foster formalization. In particular, we can observe that in this context of more stability, macroeconomic stability and higher economic growth, we can observe a reduction in unemployment during the 2000s and a reduction again in informality. So we can say that in this period, informality and unemployment were countercyclical in several Latin American countries. The point here is why they were countercyclical. And I think that it is important to recognize that in this context of higher macroeconomic stability, the functioning of the labor market, the functioning of the labor market became more predictable as a consequence of this higher macroeconomic stability, and in this context, formality is more feasible. It's more feasible to have more long-term labor contract, and in this context, it favors labor formality. Because from the perspective of employers, in this context of higher macroeconomic stability, higher labor demand, the probability of layoff, and in particular, the probability of employers having to face the cost of firing, in fact, decreases. So this is an incentive for formalization. But also, it is important to recognize the role of workers in this more positive labor market context, and in particular, in this period of increasing labor demand and decreasing unemployment, the bargaining power of workers also increase and fostering also labor formality. But I think that it is important, in particular when comparing the 90s with the 2000s, that we could see that this is a necessary condition to verify this better macroeconomic situation. This is a necessary condition for labor formalization, but not necessarily is a sufficient condition, in particular when comparing the 90s with the 2000s. So in this context, several countries have implemented different kind of policies in order to give more incentive for formalization on the one hand, or giving more labor control, strengthening labor inspection. What is the argument around here? In fact, it is linked to the discussion about taxes mentioned by Professor Ocampo. The idea, the main idea behind this kind of incentive is that the labor cost should be reduced and administrative and procedures should be simplified in order to foster labor formalization. So here we have different policies in this regard implemented during the 2000s in several Latin American countries, and we have some empirical study, impact evaluation, trying to evaluate this impact, and some of them find positive impact on labor formalization. I should say that in some cases the impact is very, very small, but in other countries the impact is higher in terms of labor formalization. It is interesting the case of Argentina, because Argentina has a very long story about a reduction in labor cost in payroll taxes, and it is interesting to note that, for instance, during the 90s, there were different policies in trying to reduce labor cost in particular in the case of Argentina, with any positive impact on labor formalization. So I think that it is important to recognize the link of labor performance, macroeconomic performance, and implementation of these kind of policies. The second part of this story has to do with the labor formalization. How many minutes do I have? The second part of this story has to do with the labor inspection. The idea here is to increase the cost of informality. And again, I think that it is important to recognize the role of this kind of policies in particular labor context, and in particular macroeconomic context verified during the 2000s, because we can see that from a political economy perspective, this kind of efforts usually are procyclical, considering the potential negative impact of this kind of control on the global labor demand. In this context, again, we have different experience in Latin America strengthening, reinforcing labor inspection with positive impact. But look at this case. In case of, for instance, one study carried out by Bosch and co-authors, that they found a negative impact on labor demand in particular case of domestic workers. So in Ecuador, we can observe an increase in formality in this kind kind of workers, but at the same time, a reduction in the global demand for domestic workers. So I think that it is important to consider this case. Two final points. The one point has to do with the distribution impact of labor formalization. I think that this is particularly a critical point because, first, inequality continues to be very high in Latin America. The second point is most empirical study we are concentrated on the role of the return to education in order to understand the reduction in wage inequality during the 2000s. But in particular, because when trying to analyze the link between inequality and informality is not so easy. A priori, it's not so easy to identify the sign, the direction of the impact of labor formalization on wage distribution, because it depends on different factors. In particular, the inequality within formal and informal workers, the wage gap in between these in both groups, and the evolution of this wage gap, and the behavior of this wage gap along the wage distribution. And finally, it depends on the location of people who were formalized, where they were initially and after the formalization process, the transit to formality by design of wages of origin and destination are also important to understand the potential impact of this labor formalization on income distribution. Very, very quickly, in general, within inequalities is higher inside informal workers than formal workers, so we will have a composition effect because after the formalization process, we will have a more proportion of a group with the lower inequality. So this is a particular way through which the reduction in informality could generate positive impact on inequality. The second point is the wage gap associated with informality. Here we carry out a different methodology in order to give more robustness to our result, but we can see that in all cases we have a penalty associated with informality. This is the same picture along this period, but one interesting point, this is an average penalty associated with informality, but when we look at in more detail this penalty across the distribution, for instance, the case of Argentina or Brazil, we can observe that this penalty is even higher at the bottom part of the income distribution than at the top part of the income distribution. So then we can discuss more in more detail, but this is important to understand the impact of the labor formalization on income inequality. And finally, this is an important point. Let me say something about this and this point. The initial and final position of people who were formalized. In this graph, on my right, we can see the distribution at the beginning, before the formalization process, the distribution of people who were formalized. In columns, we have the distribution of these people, and we can say that they were concentrating in the upper part of the income distribution. It is associated with the fact that, on average, they have a more beta vector of characteristics. And then, if you look at where they ended up in the new distribution of formal workers, we can see that they ended up located at the bottom part of the income distribution. But when we analyze the whole distribution, the whole wage distribution showing in the line, we can observe that this formalization process implied a transition from the bottom part of the income distribution to the middle part of the income distribution. So when we analyze the impact of this formalization process, we can observe that, for instance, in the case of Argentina or Ecuador, both through the composition effect and to the return effect, we can observe a positive impact of the formalization process. And in particular, if we compare the role of formality in comparison with the role of education, we can see, for instance, in the case of the Gini coefficient, the role of the formality was even more important than the role of education in order to understand the reduction in the inequality in the wage distribution. And finally, the challenges of informality in Latin America, we can say that even after this positive evolution of informality and inequality during the 2000s, the situation in the labor market continues to be very complicated, in particular associated with the high proportion of wage earners, the low proportion of wage earners in total employment, in particular in some countries such as Bolivia, or Honduras, or Peru, but also, of course, the high proportion of informal wage earners in total salary workers. For instance, look at the case of Mexico or Paraguay, where even after this informalization process, the informality in the region as a whole, and in particular in some countries, continues to be very, very high. So let me conclude saying that there was an important process of labor formalization measured through the legal approach in several Latin American countries. It is important to recognize that it took place in a particular period of high economic growth with employment creation and with the recovery of labor institutions. We can find equalizing effect, but the point here is how sustainable and sufficient are these improvements. And we say that in comparison, as already mentioned by Professor Ocampo, in comparison with the 90s, in particular in some countries such as Mexico or Paraguay, for instance, or some Central American countries, the informality is higher now than at the beginning of the 90s. So the informality continues to be very, very high in some Latin American countries. In particular, considering the current situation and the future situation in the global economy, and in particular in Latin America, or for instance the behavior of commodity prices, the situation even in fact could worsen in the future, in the near future. It is important to note that the lack or the insufficient development of productive and industrial policies. And finally, it is important to evaluate the real commitment of government with labor formalization. I would say that it is important to note that the lack of unemployment insurance in the region favors the acceptance by workers of precarious labor conditions because they need some money to survive. So in the end, the lack of unemployment insurance and informality sometimes are the two sides of the same coin. So in this context, I think that it is very important to finally define and implement long-term economic development strategy addressing the high structural heterogeneity, low productivity, low efficiency, and macroeconomic instability. It is important to analyze the institutional design of some programs such as CCTs in order to create the correct incentive for formalization. Some group of workers are particularly problematic in this context. Rural workers, domestic workers, construction, own account workers are particular crucial group of workers to be treated by specific policies because the informality is very high, the instability, and most of them are migrant workers. And finally, I think that the essential issue here is how to complement this improvement in labor market with more coherent system, more integrated system of social protection. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Sorry to make you wrong, Diego then don't pay for lunch. So now we have Sonia.
Solo 10 minutos.
I only have 10 minutes. Okay, is it working, the microphone? Yes? Okay, I would like to thank the opportunity to be here with you today. And I would like to thank you for the weather too, because I live in Chile, where it's barely raining. I don't remember the last time it rained, so rain means clear air, and I don't know, it's romantic. I feel like in Harry Potter film here. So thank you for the weather. So now I have only 7 minutes. I will try to use what the other speakers have said, because it's the same topic and some stuff are the same, to go faster, because I'm not able to speak that fast in English. So I was invited to talk for this panel that is informality over time and what happened during a specific time that was the commodity boom period. And I will talk a little bit about our research we are doing on own account workers. So I will start with this figure that showed the evolution of the commodity price so we can clearly see which period we are talking about. We can see it start, the commodity boom start by the end of 2001 until the end of mid-2011. We can see it was really a huge increase in the commodity prices. In some cases, it was 500%. Then we started, the prices started to go down, but we are still in levels above average. So the thing that we need to keep in mind is that this increase did not affect all the countries in the same way. And even, for example, if you are in the case of Chile, you are an exporter, you benefit from the higher prices of copper, you will also need to buy food. So, and the prices of food are also higher. So it's not all good. But in general, it was good for the region. As we have already seen, it was a period of positive GDP growth. So here we can see from 2000, I will concentrate though, so in this period, 2001-2011. It was a period of positive growth. It was a period of creation of employment. So the unemployment went down from this in this period. This growth in employment translates into a rise in the proportion of wage workers and employers and a fall in own account workers, as wage workers tend to be tend to have more high formality rates than the other category. It's not a surprise that, yes, we have seen an improvement in the formality in this over this period. I have to say that I measure informality here from the point of view of the person, of the employee. So I measure informality by the participation in pension system. This is closer to the approach that used Roxana, that is the legal approach. So if the person contributes to a pension system, it will be formal. Otherwise, it will be a non-formal worker. So on average, we can see that over the commodity boom period, it went from 35% in the early 2000 to 44% by 2011. But, and unfortunately, there is a, however, we can see the high difference among countries. We have countries such as Bolivia, where only 15% of workers pay for their pension, and other countries that are better off, such as, say, Roxana, that Argentina, like Argentina, Uruguay, with 73 contribute for a pension system. So these figures show the huge gap that still exists among category, among wage workers and own account workers, but also by socioeconomic status, meaning that the richest one contribute more for the pension and the poorest contribute little. This is very important from the point of view of income distribution. So, and this is related to a question that you, someone I think from Peru asked, is the role of institution. So we can say there is an ILO study that was made in 10 countries in Latin America that say that they conclude that countries that have reduced informality use an integrated approach aimed at generated growth and strengthening institutions. So it was a period of growth. There were policies done to sustain that growth, but there were also a work done in institutions, and that's what some examples that Roxana already gave to you. And when I talk about institutions, I refer to things related to standard, to incentive, and to inspection. It doesn't mean that all the countries use all the policies available. It just say that the study concluded that they used the, there was a voluntary use of a combination of policy. It was not just informality was not just addressed from one point of view. It was addressed from the side of generating the business condition for growth at the macroeconomic level. Most of the country, for example, follow prudent monetary and fiscal policy, but also at a sectoral and regional level to sustain, because sometimes, even if we have high economic growth, the impact on the labor market will depend on the labor intensity of the sector that drive this growth. So sometimes we need to use policies to develop some sectors or some regions, even if they are a small industry. And as Professor Ocampo already said, it was a huge investment in education, in to improve human capital, to update technology in the region that was very old. And it was a huge effort to increase the institutional aspect of informality. I won't go deeper here because I think we have a panel on the policy, and I will go straight on the own account workers. So we have seen that it's already a long, we have a lot of things to do in the case of informality in Latin American country. We think we need, we was trying to understand the reason for informality. So we go deeper to look at the workers, and that's what we did in the case of own account workers. Own account workers are, according to ILO definitions, are self-employed workers, meaning that their incomes will depend on the goods and services they produce, and that they do not hire, do not engage employees on a continuous basis. If they engage someone, they will become employer, not own account workers. So an employer is also a self-employed, but that hires someone, but I will use the wording self-employed or own account workers just because it's easy for me. So the first things I wanted to show is that own account workers play an important role in Latin America. Here we have the proportion of own account workers compared to other OECD countries. Maybe this is not a surprise because in general, GDP is negative associated, correlated with self-employed. But this figure shows you, for example, that in Colombia, Honduras, Dominican Republic, one in three workers are self-employed. So this is very important. And we already said during the commodity boom price, it was a decrease in informality among them, but it was not a high increase. The thing with these kind of workers is that they are very heterogeneous group. Here we will have people cleaning window on the street. We will have people producing and selling things from home. But we will also have professional. We have here many doctors, engineers, economists, because we know that in sometimes they choose to be self-employed. I don't know. They like the benefit of having, I don't know, flexible working hours or don't having a boss to complain about. So this could be a voluntary option, but this could be because the market don't give any other option for you to participate in the labor market. So the problem is that we don't know much about this kind of workers in Latin America. We don't have, in general, information. Household and employment surveys don't provide information about own account workers. So sometimes an approach is to use to divide own account workers in professional and non-professional. And that's why in the other measure that we have seen of an informality, we seen as informal all non-professional own account workers. The hypothesis is like is that professional could have chosen to be wage workers, but this is only an approximation. You know, you never know if they have really it's a voluntary option or not. So the other thing that we need to know is that there is really a huge disparity in the earnings they have. So among non-professional own account workers, there is a huge disparity in incomes. So this is very important in order to think in a policy to incentive these people. So as we have already said, informality among own account workers is very, very high in the region. But when we wanted to go deeper to understand the reason, we found out that there is really not much information about them. For example, in Argentina, in the survey, if you are a wage worker, they ask you, okay, do you contribute for a pension? Do you contribute for health? Do you have holidays? Do you have maternity leave? But if you are own account workers, the survey ends there. So we don't have much a lot of information about them. And even the countries that ask the question to own account workers, the question is not the same across countries. So that makes a little difficult to compare among countries. Here we can see that in some cases we use the question about pension, in other cases we use the question about health, and in other the pension about social security. Do you contribute for social security? That is not the same as saying, do you contribute for a pension system or not? So this figure, I wanted to summarize what we have done is just to look at in deeper detail what are the characteristics of those that are non-contributing from pension. Not a surprise, maybe, those not contributing are mainly youth, workers with a low level of education, workers in the construction sector or in the agriculture sectors, people that work few hours a week, for example, and people with low contribution capacity. These are measured by what it's called the working poor. In some cases, half of those non-contributing are poor people. So we need to keep this in mind. Then we wanted to look for, okay, what are the options for own account if an own account wanted to contribute for a pension system? This is a simplification of a bigger table we have done. Believe it or not, it was not easy to have this information, because even if we have information about the pension system for workers in general, we don't have exactly what is the case for self-employed. What are the choices? So we can see that in 15 out of 18 countries, they can contribute for a social insurance, what is called a redistributive scheme. In 8 out of 18 countries, they can save in an individual account system. In 6 out of 18, they can choose between individual account and social insurance. And only by now, only Dominican Republic don't have any option to contribute for pension for own account workers. So the other thing that we need to know is that contribution for a pension system for own account workers is in general voluntary. Only in 7 out of 18 countries it is mandatory. It has been recently become mandatory. In Chile, it will become in January 2018. And in Uruguay, it is only for those declaring incomes above a certain level. So it is a voluntary option in general. This needs to be taken into account if you want to catch those that are able to pay, because we know that in this kind of system, the benefit that we will receive when we retire will depend on the years that we have worked or contributed and on the amount we have contributed. So, and this sometimes is not much. It's 5 minutes. Okay, I'm good. And the other thing that we need to consider is that over the last 10 years, a lot of countries have expanded or created what is called, it's the third column, the non-contributory pension system. So that it's mainly certain money that they give to avoid poverty at old age. Only Honduras and Nicaragua don't have any system for to protect all older workers. So, and I will finish there. Here, as we have seen, so in the last 3 years, we had a slowdown in economic growth. I have to say that this is the impact mainly because of what happened in Brazil, and Brazil is a big player in Latin America, so it impacts the other countries. So the generation in employment has not been high, and the formalization, the gain in formalization that we had on the last decade are starting to slowing down. So we need to try to understand the reason behind informality. And we think a way to do that is to make that those that can pay start to pay. And it's that is the case of some own account workers. We need to understand and know them better. As an economist, we always complain about that we need more data, but is this the case? We need more data, we need more information about them. By now, we can say that we need to know the contribution capacity. There is a certain group that will never be able to pay the cost of formality, is what we believe. If they can choose between, say, for a future that they maybe don't know, and eat today, the choice, it may be clear. But we need to give incentives to contribute for those that can contribute. And among own account workers, there are a proportion that can. But in that case, we need to create flexible scheme, because now they are very rigid. We need to catch the attention of those that are working, for example, few hours a week. We need to, the scheme needs to be simple, because we know that there are a lot of people with very low level of education here. We need to consider also a lot of cultural aspects that are behind this. I would say that the way people think about saving is not always the same. There are also mistrust in government. So we need to take account different cultural aspects that characterize our countries. We need to think a special scheme for rural workers that are still very important in Latin American countries. Most of them declared to be self-employed, own account, so we don't have much information about them neither. And we need to think on this problem with high interinstitutional coordination. Within the department, among the department, inside the departments, and with all the other agents involved in this issue, to really improve the issue of formality in the next year. That will be everything for me.
Thank you very much, Sonia, for keeping to your 20 minutes. And now we have Angel that is going to do it in 50 minutes.
So let me start by thanking you for the invitation. I mean, your credibility as moderator is, I mean, I've been checking the time, and I would, so I, but since we are friends and this lunchtime in afterwards, I will stick to 15 minutes for sure.
No, you can use 20. It's okay.
No,
tú hiciste muy bien, 20.
And let me also thank, of course, the organizers for the invitation, CAF and here the Latin American Center, and let me join, I mean, celebrating again President García. We were together in Cartagena in Colombia, and he got a prize in every conference he went. So I see that in Europe you're already doing this tour of recognition, but I think it's pretty merited, and we hope to work on longer, for sure. I will be sharing with you our views on informality at the OECD, and some of the work is done with the OECD and other development bank in the region, not yours, but I think we are pretty much aligned. So the question was pretty straightforward: has informality decreased during the boom? And I can just put this slide and then go to lunch. It did. Formality rose from 35% of workers contributed to any pension scheme to 45%. But obviously this is not enough, and this is not enough after a decade of growth rates that were very, very high. The economic model behind these growth rates was not so fortunate, as Professor Ocampo was saying, but growth rates were extremely high. But this also takes me to another comment, is that growth is not enough. I mean, if we compare the world and we see different per capita levels and different formality levels, well, if Latin America doubles the GDP per capita, well, still we will have one out of four workers informal. So this is something else, and of course we have to do something more in order to fight for informality. So in order to understand informality, let me take you back in time a bit. This is what Otto von Bismarck saw when he went to work in the 19th century, when they imagined the pension system and the social protection system that we have. They were industrial societies, and so they imagined a system for a full-time worker working in a fabric. He was the only wage earner in the family, so with the social protection for the worker, they should be covering also the family. And the risks that they were thinking about were risks related to the work. So this is the Germany that established the system, not very different from Oxford today, by the way. But I would say this is Latin America. I mean, this is color, this is innovation, this is flexibility, this is totally different. Actually, today, the Bismarckian system in Germany doesn't work anymore because workers are not full-time workers going to the fabric. They are innovators. They are here and there. They change job. You're going to change job every 3-4 years. here your students. And this was Latin America for a long time, and this is what we did. We established social protection systems thought for a different society, different family composition, different reality, to a reality that is really full of own account workers, and of flexible informal relations. So this is why informal is normal in Latin America. It's because we established systems that were not aligned. In the 10 minutes I have, I will just share with you four basic ideas. The first one is the informal is normal, so most workers in Latin America work informally. I will tell you a bit, two or three characteristics that we think are important. Secondly, why we should care. I mean, Latin America is facing its time. I mean, now it's very important. I mean, we are two years in a row of recession. We have to do something. I mean, social advances in the last decade are now to the test. So fighting informality is one key aspect in order to address the challenges that we see in Latin America. So we cannot accept informality as another labor market or part of the labor market. We have to formalize workers. Thirdly, and very much in disagreement with Professor Ocampo, we think that taxes and informality are there together. I will explain why. We don't disagree 100%. I think we disagree 50%. So it's good to have a good debate. But finally, I will say that the package to address informality has to go beyond taxes. So taxation might play a role in the formalization packages, but it's not all. Very fast, because some of the results were made. Well, informality is 55% of workers, but comment number one, it doesn't matter what type of pension system you have. Okay, you have individual account pension systems, you have pay-as-you-go pension systems, public, private. You see informality almost in every of them. So the overselling of pension reform in the 90s was clear. When countries established these private pension systems, they said that they were going to be solving informality. Well, this is not true. But it's not true to go back to the previous ones to solve informality either, because we see high levels of informality in some countries, as Bolivia, who has now a public pension scheme. Secondly, informality is an issue of the self-employed, as was mentioned by the nice presentation by Sonia. If you are in the top 10% income earner among self-employed, well, only half of them are formals, so it's everybody is there. But also of small firms. If you are working in a small firm, in a firm that has less than five workers, you are actually as informal as a self-employed. And all of them are obliged, in theory, to be formal and to contribute. So it's not just enforcement, or at least enforcement is not done in these small firms. And thirdly, the thing I want to mention is that we have celebrating the middle class race in Latin America. Probably Germán and I and President García among the top celebrators. Here in Latin America, 40% of Latin Americans earn between $4 and $10 a day, which is this new emerging middle class, and 35% more than $10 a day. But when we go to these workers who are not poor, and we see formality rates, well, informality is between 60, 70, or 80% among this new emerging middle class in Latin America. That means that they are hyper vulnerable if the slowdowns goes on, because they are not getting the skills, they are not getting the labor protection, and they are not saving for the future. So informal is normal, and less focus especially on this socioeconomic group. Secondly, we care, and I have here a fancy dynamics that I don't know if it's going to work, but we care because when we see a lot of OECD countries, a lot of OECD countries became high-income countries in 25, 30 years. When we see Latin America, it's almost a flat line in the last 50 years of growth. All of these countries, Ireland, Israel, Poland, Singapore, Spain, Portugal, Malaysia, Greece, South Korea, were poorer than the average Latin American country in the 50s, 60s. All of them today are richer. And they are because the productivity challenge in Latin America is there. And we think that informality is part of the cause why we see a flat line in our region. Secondly, inclusion. Okay, I mentioned that informality is is also for the poor and the middle class, where we are transmitting this vulnerability towards the new generations. I mean, we just released the Latin American Economic Outlook for youth, and we analyzed what was the labor status of the youth in Latin America, depending on the income of their parents or the family. If you are a young people in Latin America living in a middle class household, well, you study and then you go to formality. Really, really straightforward. If you are poor or vulnerable, actually the probability that you go from you stop studying soon and you join the informal labor force, or you are out of the labor force, is really very high. So this vulnerability of the parents, of the senior workers today, are being transmitted into the youth today. So the inclusion challenge is key. For the inclusion challenge is key to address informality. And finally, politics, governance. And we are living very turbulent times in terms of politics. And when Latin Americans are asked whether they trust or not the elections, the results of elections, only 1 out of 3 young people in Latin America today trust the election. They are hypermobilized, but they are not believing that the system in which they are living in is the one that really reflects their opinions. This is very much reflecting also the informal relation we have with public policies. So, what can we do about it? We think that taxation matters. Obviously, there are many reasons why we think by which we are informers. First, we are very bad at long-term planning. I mean, we don't look ahead enough. Secondly, we are low productivity and low diversified economic models that make formalization more difficult. Obviously, there are imperfect designs, designs of social protection systems that are not aligned with the characteristics that we have in the region, or even independent workers that are voluntary formal, and voluntary, not many people do it. But finally, we think that there are disincentives. Disincentives because we are creating parallel schemes, or disincentives because it might be too costly. So we need data. As economists, we need data. And we don't have very good data in order to analyze this taxation. This is why at the OECD, with the IDB and other colleagues, we produced this taxing wages in Latin America, which is basically a database that I suggest you use to analyze informality, in which we try to compile for 20 Latin American countries how costly is it to be formal. And we do it by levels of income, by family composition, by gender. So you can say, what is really the cost of being informal in Latin America? And first, we would say that labor costs in Latin America are not too high. I mean, labor costs are 1/3 in Latin America than are in the OECD. And they are not too high because wages are half of a typical OECD country, but also because the social contributions and the personal income tax are 5 times lower. So that would say, then informality is not a matter of taxes if taxes and personal income tax are 5 times lower. Actually, this is what we see, and what we see is actually is especially the personal income tax is what drives a lot of the difference between Latin America and the OECD country in terms of labor costs. Because when we see, for instance, the social contributions that firms pay in a typical Latin American country and in Europe or other OECD countries, they pay the same. So inside this difference in among the cost of formality, there are, in some cases, social contributions that might be a cost for the firm or the worker to decide whether to be formal or not. And actually, this is what the formal firms and formal workers are paying. What about the informals? Because we want to move this 55% of informals to formality. And the fact is that in the informality, you tend to earn less than the formal ones. And sometimes you earn less than the minimum wage. But the system requires you to contribute from the minimum wage, as if you earn the minimum wage. So we calculate that thing. And if you are, let's say, in the 30% poorer informal workers in Latin America, you're asking these workers between 80 and 40% of their income, which is already low income, lower than the minimum wage. So I don't know if this is the barrier, but obviously you have to value a lot the benefit of formality to renounce to 40, 50, 60% of your wage if you can, because you have to eat, educate your children, and build your house. There are Americas Latinas, obviously. There are Chile, a country in which generally everything works, and you have high levels of formality, at least in comparison with the regional average. You have others in Central America where everybody's informal despite very low levels of social contributions. And then you have like perfect storm countries, as Colombia or Peru, where the combination of the minimum wage and social contributions make for this vulnerable middle class relatively expensive to move from informality to formality. And if you don't value formality, why to do it? If they don't enforce you, if they don't monitor you, well, you stay there. And we think that's a mistake for productivity, inclusion, and governance issues. We are in an academic setting, so obviously I did my PhD on this issue, and we revised 52 empirical papers, and the dispersion of taxes and informalities is big. So it depends if the minimum wage is binding, and we see that for many Latin American countries is binding. It depends how much you value your pensions. It's the link between what you pay and what you get, or more importantly, the link between what you think you are paying and what you think you are going to be getting, which is not the same. And also some issues of coordination of the wage bargaining. But anyhow, we think that taxation is part of the story. It's not part of all the story. And I'm concluding here. It's not part of all the story because, well, if you ask citizens from Lima or from Mexico who are over 45, if they have thought about retirement, well, half of them say never in my life. So obviously we have an issue of communication, of information, of financial knowledge that we have to solve. So that's why the package to address formality has to take many things on board, like policies, productive development policies to address the issue of productivity, obviously these issues to address the issue of lack of knowledge. But we think that impartially, we have to put an ingredient of lowering the cost of moving from formality to informality. And here I would say we have at least four instruments, more incentives. Some of them are monetary incentives, some of them can be just different services. But and here is where I just disagree 50% with Professor Ocampo. We need more tax revenues in Latin America, and we need social contributions, but maybe we can do them more progressive. We can give exemptions based on income so that these low and middle income workers pay a bit more, and those who have higher income pay more, and more personal income tax, by the way. These are the ingredients. But subsidies to make this barrier lower. Enforcement, pension system, social security system should be mandatory for all workers, and not voluntary for some, because actually if it's voluntary, people don't get in, but be flexible in order to make it easier. Increase information, impact evaluation. We don't really know what works, but probably a combination of these policies might work, but we have to compile more evidence. We have some evidence, but this is not the silver bullet. And finally, innovation. Today we have technology and we have behavioral economics that says that people react or not to different incentives in a different way depending on how we communicate. So it's the time to innovate in these policies. Among these policies, I think skills is something that we are pushing every institution because we have 130 million informal workers, and at the same time half of our firms say we have projects and we don't find the worker to fill that vacancy. And Latin America is a champion in the skills gap. It's a champion. In every region, companies complain about taxes, complain about regulation, complain about not finding the worker, where in our is the best, number one in complaining. So there's something there to fill this match that could help in order to address informality. So to conclude, informal is normal. 55% of workers, also middle class workers, and this is key. Second, we don't like it. We don't accept it. I mean, the addressing the productivity, governance, and inclusion challenge needs to address informality. We think subsidies, progressive subsidies to social contributions might work because the barriers for some workers are extremely high. But in a package in which we also do productive development policies and some innovations in policy making. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Well, you can see that Angel is a Spanish guy that became Latin America many years ago, so we like that. So we have plenty of time for questions, 50 minutes, so the floor is open for questions, comments. I have Diego, I have, of course, Professor Ocampo.
So, question, a very quick comment. The question to everyone is, much of the debate at the end, it's a debate that we have had for a long time, which is whether the causality direction between informality and productivity, right? And in a way, Angel, one part of what you presented could be read as you think it goes from productivity to informality, so that, from informality to productivity, so that the fact that we are creating very informal economies leads to low productivity. Others have presented the other way around. So more than asking you which direction is, how can we do research that tells us more about that? How could we think about better ways to think about whether the causality goes in one direction or another, knowing that, of course, there's a huge problem of endogeneity and reverse causality as well. But how can we think about new ways that move us a little bit from the old debate? And then the second, which will become later, part of what I'm slightly more skeptical, I would want to ask to pressure you, especially Angel, on the issue of reduction of payroll taxes, is we cannot separate the economic incentives from the politics, right? And part of the problem is that in several countries, I know a lot about Costa Rica, so Costa Rica is a good example, charging payroll taxes is much easier than charging for any other one. So I think that we run the risk politically. I'm not saying it. So we run the risk by having an agenda that reduces and saying, yes, but we need to increase income taxes to do the one without doing the other because of political reasons. So I would encourage all of us to think about the politics and the economics together, something that, for example, Santiago Levy never does.
Let's say three questions and then we answer.
No, I have a terminological issue. I'm not going to discuss actually the taxes. I will do it in private. I think he's wrong, but anyway.
But 150.
Yeah.
No, about 80%. No. We has to do with the question of this panel. So you can read the evidence the following way. For me, an informal worker is, in the traditional definition of ILO, that person who is in a small, very small enterprise or self-employed or domestic worker, which is the low productivity in the definition of CEPAL. Okay, you know, you can incorporate them into the social protection system. My reading of that is that, yes, I mean, remember my graphs about the improvement in social protection. There has been an increased social protection of informal workers, but they remain informal workers so long as their conditions of work continues to be in a very small enterprise or self-employed. So I would not say that is a reduction in informality. I would say it's an increased coverage in the social protection system of informal workers. But informality, in the traditional definition of ILO and CEPAL, according to my data, which is CEPAL data, has increased, period. I think we have been successful in, let's say, in social, increasing the social protection, which is pension and health. Actually, much more, I mean, you both use pension, but in health is much more impressive, the capacity to include those informal workers into the system. I think there are two different issues, because the economic issue is more related to the traditional definition of ILO The other is something that you can do through social policy. And again, I think that is consistent with my view that we have been much more successful in social policy than in economic policy. Yeah.
One more question before giving back. No.
Okay, so you guys.
On how to evaluate the relation between informality and productivity, you're absolutely right. I think they go both ways. And how we can do it, I think we have the last Colombian tax reform is an example that is being evaluated, in which you can say whether actually productivity in relation to the minimum wage affects informality, yes or no. And there are some good techniques because it was different by the size, by the level of the wage of the worker. It was different if the firm is capital intensive or labor intensive. So there are discontinuities there, at least to address whether I'm 100% wrong or Guillermo is 10% right. So it's not easy, obviously. And the other way of round informality towards productivity, I think the channel of skill accumulation is the one that I think might be one, because formal workers tend to access all the skill formation or skill accumulation, and informal workers rarely do so. If we somehow identify their impact on different productivity levels, that would be a way to. For me, all of these two channels make sense, but I encourage all of the researchers to try to have a cleaner estimates. And secondly, on the question on social security contributions, we are not. I mean, I work at the IDB. We published a book on pensions and jobs, and we didn't propose just the levy model. So I know how things get when you talk about taxes and informality. My idea is, our idea is not to renounce to social contributions, because you are collecting 2-4% in some countries. If you add that's the goal of many tax reforms in many countries. So don't renounce to that. But the composition inside those social security contributions is pervasive, because we are seeing that for the bottom 30% is more than 50-60% of their income. So, I mean, a subsidy or a progressive subsidy on social security contributions, maintaining their revenues, is something that we have to do. That, on top of the personal income tax, which when I propose it, there is when they say you are too European. Well, I might be too European, but a personal income tax that collects 2% in Latin America versus 8% in OECD countries is a huge funding gap.
Yes, regarding the question of Professor Ocampo about the definition of informality, I think that in the end we have, again, different approaches to informality. And in particular, in fact, ILO incorporated this legal informality as a part of the definition of informality. So in fact, that they have the more recent definition, including both the productive and legal approach. I think that in the end it is important to differentiate both approaches, because they are complementary. In fact, if you look at the data, the overlapping between these and both definitions is very high, but it is not so full. So I think that it is interesting, for instance, to know that in several Latin American countries, the illegal informality continues to be high, even in the formal sector. So I think that it is important in order, because I think that the definition of policies in these cases are different. If you are talking about the informal sector, of course, we need more productive policies in order to increase the productivity, to reduce the heterogeneity, to reduce or to increase the efficiency. But if we are talking about the legal approach, we need, for instance, in the case of big companies, we need more enforcement into the labor law. So I think this is the reason to distinguish between these and both approaches. But in the end, they are part of the same phenomenon, especially nowadays in Latin America. that because the big part of this reduction in the legal informality was verified in the formal sector. So the problem now is how to reduce, how to continue with the formalization process in the informal sector. And I think that it is more difficult. And related to the question of Diego, in fact, I think that your question is even more important now at the beginning of the period because, again, the informality, the non-fulfillment with the labor legislation is relatively higher now in the informal sector than at the beginning, because at the beginning of the period we have this problem not only in the informal sector but also in the formal sector. So the question, the relationship between productivity and informality, I think that in the end is the crucial aspect. And I think that in this point it is interesting to note, because we have a different, a very high heterogeneity across countries. So I think that it is not so easy to analyze Latin America as a whole in order to identify exactly the channel that links between informality and productivity. I think that there are some experiences regarding evaluating some micro cases or, for instance, some micro impact evaluation regarding policies in order to increase productivity. But I think that one of the problems in Latin America is the lack in the design of productive policies, is the lack of this link between productivity, some policies in order to increase, increase productivity. In general, they don't consider this aspect of labor formalization. So I think that it's important to analyze, but in more detail, not an aggregate level, but also so in more micro level, because I think that the quality and the relationship could be different.
Sonia, something to add?
Yeah. Just, yes, I agree with Roxana on the case of they are both complementary definition of formalization. The ILO is incorporating this new definition, the legal definition, and in CEPAL we are trying to do so because we think that the world of work is changing. I mean, we cannot consider that just because we are a small enterprise we will be informal or that we are not gaining a lot of money. We could be, I don't know, two ICT workers, with a friend, we create a small business, we sell our service to other countries, and
that would not be informal in any definition. Because it's still labor. It's non-skilled labor. That's what is informal.
No, it's small enterprise or low skill level or non-professional or
non-professional on account, but it's just in the case of on account workers. Exactly. In the case of salaries, they are belonging to the, beyond this discussion about the measurement of informality, I think that another interesting point is how to get the inclusion in the social security system, considering the contributory and non-contributory system. This is why I prefer, in fact, to analyze if you are registered or not in the social security system more than the coverage of social pensions or, for instance, some kind of different non-contributory system. Because nowadays in the region we have this in two parts of the coverage, contributory and non-contributory. In my approach to the legal approach is not just in the coverage of social pensions from contributory and non-contributory, but it's specifically in the link with the contribution to the social security system, the contributory system. So I think that this is another discussion about the approach to the legal conceptualization of informality.
We can take one or two more questions, and that will be it. First here, and then over there.
I'm sorry for taking the word again, but it's just that I'm really finding the panel super interesting because it's related with my PhD research. So it's just that what I think is that for me it's very hard because from what I perceive from them is rather like a lot of potential, actually. And I think that for me it's rather problematic, like always categorizing them as non-productive or productive, because I think that one of the things that we could say for sure about these films is that they are super heterogeneous. So like Afsonia was saying like some moments ago, like there are even some professionals that are there. So I think that normally, well, actually what I am doing is somehow tackling the problem that normally the way in which we categorize is somehow like a bit biased, because it's always depending like on a certain characteristic rather than, for example, given their characteristics, what is, for example, their probability of success. So that is, for example, what I do, and I think that that leads you to a better classification of firms. What I think is that since I am basing my point in Mexico, then what I find, it's also like, again, like the discussion of skills very interesting. Because if we compare Mexico like in the 19th and now, like the gap, like education has for sure increased. But then when you do like other analysis, you really notice that despite this increase in official formation, like they are really lacking skills. So I think that it's more rather like an issue of really somehow making or providing them some understanding about the general problems, like what we were saying, like do you see the future, are you able to track your accounts and things like that. So and I think that in general, well, it's rather super important to include them, because in the end, if our growth model is somehow, or was in the beginning, to somehow join to the global economy, we cannot exclude them. I mean, we rather have to really take them with us and then make them grow together somehow.
Thank you. Final question over there.
Yes, thank you. I'm puzzled by a few different elements of your presentations. One is the heterogeneity of the informal economy. The other is the response of pensions that we have a system that is no longer fit for purpose. And then that the informal economy is normal in Latin America. And I'm wondering how to bring these three elements together. If the informal economy is normal, what do the informal workers themselves want in terms of social security or labor inclusion? If you think about the street vendors, my guess is that many street vendors in Latin America would like to continue being informal workers because it gives them flexibility, it gives them... So is a formal inclusion, or is inclusion in formal labor markets, a policy that should be pursued in the light of what informal workers themselves would like?
Who wants to take the question?
Well, that was a comment.
Okay.
I mean, these social protection systems exist because people underestimate their life, overestimate the health they're gonna be having. They don't save enough, and all the risks involved in work, they think they are not gonna be affecting them. So by those problems, those limitations we have as humans, these ones I was mentioning as our limitations to look in the future, are still here for the street vendor or for the executive. As development institutions, we care more for the street vendors than for the executive. So if the executive vice president of a firm wants to save or not, well, his issue. But for these other ones, we care. And what we see is that the vulnerability of all these workers is too high to ignore. Still today, one out of four citizens in Latin America is poor, and four out of ten are close to be poor and might get into poverty if the slowdown goes on. So we think we have to enforce, but obviously we have to be flexible. And I think this flexibility involves that was my message. Costs that are lower for some of them that are today. Knowledge, information. I mean, communicate. What are the benefits to be in the formal economy, and short-term benefits? Because what you see in that some small firm informal workers is that they don't value benefits that they're going to be getting in 20, 25 years, but they value, for instance, an insurance. You are a farm worker, and insurance against bad weather. you're a taxi driver, well, insurance, circulation insurance that is subsidized. So combine also the short term and the long term. These packages, I think they are the ones that for this type of work at my work, but we have to design and evaluate what works because we have a huge uncertainty. But action, I think is no question about it.
Roxana, Sonia?
No.
Okay.
Well, a round of applause for the speakers.